I'd like now to introduce our first keynote speaker, John Edwards. And John was appointed as the Privacy Commissioner of New Zealand in February 2014, after a more than 20-year career practicing law. John has degrees in law and also public policy from Victoria University of Wellington, and has advised and represented a wide range of clients from the public and private sector. In addition to a practice specialty in the law of information and privacy law, he held warrants as a district inspector for mental health and as a district inspector for intellectual disability services, and has provided legal services to the Kingdom of Tonga. In October 2014, John was elected as the chair of the Executive Committee of the International Conference of Data Protection and Privacy Commissioners.
Where should I go? Thanks, Alex. Thanks, Gihan. Kia ora tātou, ngā mihi, kia koutou, e tēnei wā. I want to acknowledge the tangata whenua of this place as I welcome our international guests, as well as the many representatives of privacy in civil society, in academia, and in business from New Zealand. I'm not actually talking about security and privacy, although it will come up, of course. But in this environment, I thought, with so many different jurisdictions and cultural and legal traditions represented, it might be useful to question some of the assumptions about the topic of privacy and how it is perceived in different countries. When we come here together representing many different countries, languages, cultural and legal traditions to talk about privacy, how can we be sure that we share a common understanding of the concept? Are we talking about the same thing, or do we each have a slightly different concept in mind when we use the term? I have to admit that sometimes when I'm in an international forum, I wonder if there aren't quite a range of different understandings. If you look at legal writing, I think we can agree that the most general definition is freedom from interference or intrusion, or, as articulated by Warren and Brandeis, the right to be let alone. But privacy means different things to different people, to different cultures, to different communities. At the same time, we live in an increasingly connected global world in which it is often said information or data knows no borders. And information originating from an apparently simple domestic transaction might pass through three or more countries. So there's a tension. And arriving at a common definition or meaning of the concept of privacy is one of the challenges privacy regulators and the international privacy community face. In the recent Hollywood film Arrival, the actor Amy Adams, who I'm reliably informed is no relation to the Minister of Justice of the same name, who has more than a passing interest in privacy, plays a linguist who is recruited by the US government to communicate with newly arrived extraterrestrial visitors. The main conflict in the film comes from humans trying to learn the aliens' language. The aliens, for example, talk about a weapon. Debate rages in the film about whether they mean a weapon or a tool. Both terms are quite similar, but the slight differences in meaning bring dramatically different consequences. Tool, as a word, builds trust, while the word weapon instigates fear and mistrust. When we debate the term privacy, we are also trying to find common ground between different cultures' definition of ostensibly the same thing. In a world with human languages numbering between 6,000 and 7,000, the word privacy can mean different things. These meanings are often nuanced and shaped by culture, society, and history. In our early human history, privacy was a lesser priority in conditions of subsistence existence. Living in small rural communities, most humans had little concept of privacy until fairly recently. Sex, breastfeeding, domestic quarrels, toileting and bathing were usually performed in front of other members of the small communities that were the cradle of mankind. The anthropologist Jared Diamond observed that because hunter-gatherer children sleep with their parents, either in the same bed or in the same hut, there is no privacy. Children see their parents having sex. In one tribal society, parents took no special precautions to prevent their children from watching them having sex. They just scolded the child and told it to cover its head with a mat So there's a basic sense of privacy, at least. In the 1951 book, Patterns of Sexual Behaviour, the American researchers Cleland Ford and Frank Beach studied the sexual behaviour of 191 cultures and found that the preference for privacy was instinctive. In 9 of 12 societies where homes have separate bedrooms, people prefer to have sex indoors. In those cultures without homes with separate rooms, sex is more often preferred outdoors. Often the desire for privacy was overridden by the need to survive. The anthropologist Jean Briggs found herself being ostracized by her native North American Utku host family after daring to explore the wilderness alone for a day. She made the observation, "How forlorn I would be in the wilderness if they forsook me. Far, far better to suffer loss of privacy." The concept of individual privacy is usually associated with Western culture, and as you can see, it was a concept foreign to some cultures until recent times. There's also the subtle distinction between privacy and secrecy. Ontologically, the word privacy has been described as an example of an untranslatable lexeme with many languages. There is simply no specific word for it. In Russian, the words for solitude, secrecy, and private life combine to capture the essence of what we in this room might mean by the term privacy. Other languages adopt privacy as a loan word. Privacy in Bahasa Indonesia, or la privacy in Italian. In Mandarin Chinese, privacy means secrecy, solitude, and seclusion, all or each of these things. Meanwhile, in Islamic cultures, the notion of privacy has no conceptual autonomy in legal literature. Rather, it has to do with a cluster of attitudes and norms. A famous line in the Quran says, "Do not enter houses other than your own unless you have asked permission and greeted the inhabitants." The Quran also includes a general injunction against prying and spying on people. In New Zealand, Western concepts of privacy, especially legal concepts, are centered on the individual. Western intellectual ideas have for many centuries developed along the lines of the rights of the individual. However, many indigenous peoples, including New Zealand Maori, have a different focus that is more likely to emphasize the good of the collective, the rights of the collective, and the solutions for the collective. The Maori word tapu perhaps provides us with the best analogy to the European aspect of European concepts of privacy, with its several overlapping shades of meaning, including sacred, prohibited, or unclean. New Zealand Maori legal academic Kylie Quince described tapu as a status that exists when a person, place, or thing is placed under restriction or dedicated for a particular purpose. She says, in a legal sense, this relates to the inviolability of the human person to be free from physical assault and interference. A related concept is that of mana, which Kylie Quince describes as my reputation and my self-esteem, both how others think of me and how I think of myself. Mana and tapu combine in many settings to produce ideas and reactions which closely parallel European responses to privacy invasions. In a Law Commission review of this country's Privacy Act, the reviewers observed that in the state's drive to collect health information, if Maori are confident that their information will be used in a way that is empowering or mana enhancing, they will be more willing to agree to the collection and use of that information. But if Maori believe that information will be used in a way that is derogatory to Maori and which diminishes mana, they will be reluctant to share information. So we have similar concepts which in the West might be assigned to the individual being claimed as a right accorded to a collective, whether that be a whānau hapū or a broader ethnic group. Robert C. Post of the Yale Law School wrote in 2001 that privacy is a value so complex, so entangled in competing and contradictory dimensions, so engorged with various and distinct meanings, that I sometimes despair whether it can be usefully addressed at all. People are different, and our ideas of privacy are shaped by culture, religion, language, history, and architecture. Through the ages, there has been no single unifying concept of privacy, but that is changing. These different perspectives that existed have slowed the establishment of a set of internationally accepted principles on privacy. The constitutions of many countries do not explicitly mention privacy and an individual's right to privacy. In Indonesia, for example, the constitution does not explicitly mention privacy. However, Article 28G protects the right to dignity and to feel secure, concepts that are often related to the right to privacy in national constitutions of other countries. In Kenya, the constitution specifically protects the right to privacy. It states every person has the right to privacy, which includes the right not to have their person, home, or property searched, their possessions seized, information relating to their family or private affairs unnecessarily required or revealed, or the privacy of their communications infringed. But according to Privacy International, civil society groups in Kenya report it is difficult to work on privacy and surveillance in that country, as the issue is not widely deemed important by society in general. This is in part because the increased number of security threats has enabled a strong national security discourse to overshadow concerns about individuals' privacy. Privacy International notes that privacy is often subsumed by other human rights issues. So societal values on privacy change in a temporal basis, depending on the domestic circumstances and the needs of the population and individuals. I suggest a universal acceptance of a singular definition of privacy is not going to happen because it would be impossible to get agreement at an instrumental level. How do we get the United States, China, the Republic of Korea, and Ghana, for example, to agree upon a universal set of privacy expectations? More importantly, should we even try? Is it important that we all agree? We disagree or have different practices in so many other areas of our cultural or legal practice. Why should we in privacy? Do we need a global standard? Is it possible to abstract what are described as privacy values to a level that receives acceptance across the entire global community? Well, there I think we may have some promise. One of the abstractions is data protection, which I see as a subset of a wider group of privacy values, but which is a term often used interchangeably with privacy, which can add to the confusion. For example, we see an increasing diversity of countries in the Asia-Pacific region, in Africa, adopting data protection laws, but the underlying values and social and cultural traditions on which these laws are based may represent quite divergent approaches to the concept of privacy in those communities from that which informs the similar looking laws in countries in Western Europe or North America, which themselves begin from quite different points when it comes to recording the respective rights and obligations on data processors or generators and data subjects. So if we in Asia Pacific or in Africa think that elsewhere there is an agreed set of privacy values, then we are misinformed, because at every international forum I've attended in the last 2 years, we've seen a raging debate across the Atlantic between the European approach and the American approach to privacy, which is, begins from different precepts and different values and primacies of different rights, such as freedom of expression being a fundamental human right versus the right to privacy being described in Europe as that a fundamental and inalienable human right. There's a view among some technologists, as well as some governments, that accommodating privacy concerns and safeguards is a curb on technological innovation, or on the aspiration of building a better model citizen, more efficient cities and safer societies. And reflecting that transatlantic discourse that I mentioned, the sort of the insult that's cast from the United States across to Europe is Google could never have happened in Germany, and variations on that theme. But if we look away from that relationship, which dominates much of the international discourse on privacy, and perhaps look a bit closer to home, China's government is exploring plans for a social credit system which utilizes big data to hold citizens to account for their financial decisions. To do so, the government is enlisting some of the country's best known companies. According to the Wall Street Journal, Alibaba's Alipay payment system is one of 8 companies involved in the first experiments around China's social credit scoring system. Alipay will compile scores based on a user's smartphone brand and what they buy online, before offering users perks for high scores. The information helps the government monitor and reward citizens with higher credit scores. The scores will not only be based on a user's lending and spending numbers, but also on what the money is spent on. If friends have a poor lending reputation, this reflects badly on the person, just as prolonged playing of video games, one report explained. Buying diapers indicates responsibility and therefore scores well. China's government says it wants to roll out the social credit score program nationwide by 2020. And if that sounds like science fiction to you, I suggest that you subscribe to Netflix and check out Black Mirror, and you'll see that fiction has only narrowly preceded this reality. Meanwhile, in the United Kingdom, the British financial regulator, FCA, has warned that insurance companies could use available data to identify customers who shop around and those who do not, and could differentiate pricing accordingly. The warning comes as the availability of more personal information on social media and devices such as telematics boxes that monitor driving habits mean the insurance industry is moving towards quotes based on observed behavior of individuals rather than grouped assessments of risk factors. One telematics provider, Octo, launched an app this year that shared customers' driving data with insurers so they could bid for custom. It claimed that the safest drivers would get the lowest premiums. Imagine that model rolled out to social insurance or health insurance or accident insurance. If you have the misfortune to be in an industry that has low safety standards, you could find yourself perversely being rewarded with the highest possible premiums. Also this year, the British insurer Admiral announced that it planned to use Facebook status updates and likes to help establish which customers were safe drivers and therefore entitled to a discount. Privacy advocates called the proposal intrusive, and it was blocked by Facebook hours before it was due to launch. Not because of any breach of legal norms, but because of the creep factor, the yuck factor, the cultural norms and expectations. I think that the security debate is in the background of all of this, so I do need to address it, Alex. Due to Edward Snowden, one of the hottest privacy debates of recent times has been about the relationship between security and intelligence agencies and the community, how those agencies derive their legitimacy, and how that legitimacy can be harmed or enhanced. So how does society engage in the conversation with government and big business when it lacks the information necessary to make a fully informed choice about the balances and trade-offs? Can accountability mechanisms keep pace with change and not get left behind and rendered obsolete? I want to take a slightly different tack from one you might expect a privacy commissioner to take in discussing the Snowden revelations. A lot of people, both within and outside the countries directly implicated in the material Snowden leaked, simply didn't care. Or they expected the governments to be doing exactly what was reported. In some countries, there is a very high level of comfort for agents of the state having access to whatever information they need to keep people safe and to stop terrorists. We saw outrage and shock from some NGOs, and we saw righteous indignation from some countries, which within a few months of the NSA-GCHQ interception activities being revealed, were exposed themselves as being involved in exactly the same kind of activity. So we do see, I won't say double, I would say multiplicities of standards in this area. The fact that those revelations from Snowden coincided with an explosion in the data ecosystem has led to a complex and interrelated series of responses that do not necessarily, as a whole, demonstrate a consistency of values and imperatives. In April 2015, the United Nations Human Rights Council adopted a resolution to appoint a special rapporteur on the right to privacy. The resolution directed the special rapporteur, amongst other responsibilities, to report on alleged violations of the right to privacy, including in connection with the challenges arising from new technologies. Those developments are reactive responses to perceived abuses. At the same time, governments are trying to capture for their populations the benefits of the digital economy. A consensus seems to have developed that increasing participation in the digital economy is a good thing. that there are enormous quantifiable benefits to be had from investing in online infrastructure to deliver a range of social and economic services. A precondition to that engagement, to the realization of the benefits of technology, is that the users must have trust in the system, and that without that trust, that personal information will be kept and transmitted safely and securely, those benefits will not be realized. When privacy is a prerequisite for governments and businesses benefiting from technology, the value proposition for agreeing on some common and consistent approaches to privacy or data protection, call it what you will, becomes evident. We saw this at the OECD ministerial in June in Cancun. It was entitled The Digital Economy, Innovation, Growth and Social Prosperity. Paragraph 5 of the ministerial declaration recorded ministers' commitment to promote digital security risk management and the protection of privacy at the highest level of leadership to strengthen trust and develop to this effect collaborative strategies that recognize these issues as critical for economic and social prosperity, support implementation of coherent digital security and privacy risk management practices with particular attention to the freedom of expression and the needs of small and medium enterprises and individuals, foster research and innovation, and promote a general policy of accountability and transparency. So there's a whole lot packed into that statement about the preconditions for the benefits of digital economies being enjoyed by the broadest possible population. If we abstract privacy to a level of trust in personal information management practices, then it doesn't really matter whether one country regards privacy as a fundamental human right and another finds that concept so vague as to be unmanageable. It avoids a primacy of rights, for example, setting freedom of expression against individual privacy. If you ask the question, what is required to maintain trust in our management of personal information, you can move past prescriptive rules and absolutism and address the underlying question of how competing needs from personal data can be accommodated within a single framework. Returning to the security and intelligence element, for example, few, if any, people would deny the legitimacy of the state to act to protect its population. Most of us would regard it as a duty, one of the most fundamental duties of the state to its people. We entrust agencies with powers in order to allow them to do so. We expect that trust to be respected. The fact that in certain prescribed circumstances, an agency of the state will need to access and use personal information other than for the purpose it was provided should surprise no one. If we can agree on a set of principles governing how that access should be granted and have some transparency to ensure that those principles are respected, we should be able to meet these competing needs. There is as yet no internationally agreed standard for the conduct of intelligence and security activities. In my view, efforts should be made to develop and articulate some. If that sounds like naive folly, then let me remind you that even the conduct of war is subject to legally enforceable agreements, which has always struck me as the biggest absurdity of the rule of law, that you can kill somebody with this weapon, but not with that one. The need for this conversation was starkly demonstrated to me when I was at a recent international intelligence oversight forum in Bucharest, the first of its sort. I was struck by the lack of agreement on the meanings of basic terms, which is a prerequisite for having any kind of conversation about acceptable conduct. The same activity, for example, a requirement of telecommunications companies to retain content and or metadata for a certain period, was described by some observers as mass surveillance, a term strenuously rejected by many others. The same observers might regard as mass surveillance a warehousing of communications data accessible by search terms which had to be individually approved by an overseeing judge. The architects and administrators of that scheme argued that it was entirely consistent with international norms requiring lawful and proportionate access to private communications. But until we have an international conversation about the parameters of that legitimate activity and the elements required to maintain trust, such as independent oversight, transparency reporting, a sound basis in the rule of law, we are destined to continue the cycle of criticizing the activities of some countries while maintaining a blind spot in respect of our own. Governments have three broad options on how they choose to regulate privacy and data protection, and many shades in between. But the first is an environment where governments and organisations can do anything with personal information. There are no safeguards and no rules except for what can be negotiated as a private contract. The individual is basically powerless to influence or even to know the information which organisations hold about them, and government has few, if any, privacy statutes that protect personal information. This is the most permissive of models. At the other end of the spectrum is a quite prescriptive model, under which clear legal authority is required to make use of personal information beyond that which has been expressly consented by the data subject. So at the poles we have, do whatever you want unless it's expressly restricted. At the other end, only act in accordance with an expressly authorising legal framework. In the middle, there's a mixed model of market forces and government intervention. This regulatory approach introduces friction into the process by which organisations collect, store, and disclose personal information. Individuals also have access to information about them and have measures of redress if their personal information is being used unlawfully. This regulatory model puts the onus on an affected individual to enforce their rights and creates litigation risk for an agency that decides it can do whatever it wants with personal data. This is the approach we have adopted in New Zealand, a law based on the OECD privacy principles that are flexible enough to foster economic growth and technological innovation, while also giving individuals the right to exert some level of control over their personal information. In May this year, the World Bank issued a World Development Report called Digital Dividends that highlighted, among other things, the need for consistent and reliable data protection regulation as a key factor and reducing inefficiencies and promoting consumer confidence in the online world. The World Bank, as you might expect, is no cheerleader for privacy or data protection and didn't express a preference about what the correct model might be. However, it did note that inconsistent approaches add friction and inefficiency into international trade and could be an impediment to realizing and releasing what they've called the digital dividend. It would be overly simplistic and I think plain wrong to think that the actions of security and intelligence agencies are the sole drivers of the international conversation on data privacy. We are seeing an international trend in consumer demand for privacy protective products, whether in hardware like the iPhone or in software such as encrypted in encrypted messaging services like WhatsApp or temporary media like Snapchat. The international technology and market research company Forrester's declared that 2015 would be the year privacy and security became competitive differentiators. We saw that happen and saw the trend continue in 2016. We have seen Apple, Facebook, and Microsoft in the courts to stand up for their customers' rights to privacy. We have seen Google and Facebook and many others subject to the high-profile regulatory attention of European data protection regulators. So rather than framing privacy regulation as a drag, perhaps we can reframe it as a market-leading response to consumer demand. It is another trick of language, to return to the theme, to establish false dichotomies. We've all heard the false argument that you can have privacy or security, but not both. Similarly, it is in the interests of some to argue that strong privacy regulation is incompatible with innovation. In my view, there is no trade-off to be made between innovation, enterprise, and privacy. Good privacy and security practices, when designed into new technologies, become a selling point and improve the whole network. Ensure that access to networks, systems, content, communications, and metadata by agents of the state is undertaken only in accordance with lawful authority and only when that access is necessary and proportionate. I do believe that privacy is a fundamental human right, but like many other rights, it is not absolute. Just as I cannot exercise my right to freedom of expression in this room to shout fire, nor can I exercise my right to privacy to prevent the detection of a trade in child pornography. Access to communications by law enforcement, security, or intelligence agencies should be according to consistent legal standards regardless of the jurisdiction. Nor does privacy only mean secrecy, notice and consent, or a number of other limited and culturally specific manifestations of individual autonomy. New concepts are emerging within the family of privacy-related rights, which don't fit with a limited linguistic construction of the term. Think of the concept of data portability, the right to receive your data in a machine-readable format so you can take it to another provider of the service that originally collected it from you. That's not about stopping the flow of data, it's about reinforcing and affirming the individual's right against the organisation which is profiting from that data. I was quite surprised at a conference last year to meet the general counsel for LinkedIn, so quite a senior executive, who said when she met me, oh yes, I saw your tweet. And the tweet she was referring to was one which I can't remember the details, but after the acquisition of LinkedIn by Microsoft was announced, I tweeted, 26 billion is amount, you know, was how much the purchase price was, divided by 335 million active daily users, equals your data is worth $633. And of course she said it was wildly inaccurate, but but you know, the data is the business model, and increasingly we have to try and correct an information and power asymmetry. So back to data portability. Just as number portability has proved crucial in promoting competition in the mobile phone sector, so is data portability an important concept in promoting consumers' rights and facilitating the ease of access to and exit from telecommunications, online and other services. Data portability is part of the European General Data Protection Regulation due to come into effect in 2018 and will need to be provided for beyond Europe. It's a concept that we're looking at closely here. I'll draw to a close, but despite the difficulties in reaching a universal understanding about the nature of privacy, a common understanding of the elements of privacy is emerging in New Zealand and in many other countries. Our laws reflect this need to be able to protect and control information about ourselves and our need to withdraw, physically or mentally, from society or to exercise some autonomy over our information, or at least be informed about it. Privacy, as defined by this common understanding, is important to ensure that we feel secure. If we are unable to control who knows information about us, we will feel insecure, at least in part because the boundaries of our relationships become uncertain. We started with language. What we need is a deep discussion about what we mean when we talk internationally about concepts like privacy and data protection, about trust. We need to understand not only what we have in common in these understandings, but also to make a greater effort to question our assumptions about how other jurisdictions and cultures approach these questions and values. And if we see difference, to make a genuine effort to understand that difference, rather than to assert a cultural and legal superiority. This is the ideal forum for that conversation, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you and to open up that discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. We have about 5 minutes. I don't know if you're prepared to take questions or not. It's not normal after a keynote to have questions, but...
No, look, I'm perfectly happy to
if you're happy
take questions.
To, yeah. if people have a couple of quick questions for John, feel free to.
I suspect rigorous cross-examination from such an informed and deep-thinking audience, yes.
One of the, I think you're exactly right in the points you made, I completely agree with. And one of the frustrating things that I've been thinking about is the law's sort of tendency to over-rely on certain concepts to the exclusion of lots of other ones. And the one that I'm thinking about right now is the notion of control, which you mentioned at the close of your speech. And I wonder if you've thought about ways in which we can improve the notion of control, because it seems like a lot of what we have now with a lot of our data protection regimes is we overinvest it, right? That we say control is sort of everything, and that's the way that we enable people to sort of set privacy preferences for themselves. But we ask so much of them. I wonder if you've thought about a way to sort of balance that. And I particularly like your notion of trust. as also a sort of way to think about maybe privacy issues?
Yeah, I think so. It's a really good question because what we've seen is some crypto control or pseudo control. You know, the European concept of notice and consent is folly. And you know, the consent and notice as a prerequisite for entering into a commercial transaction simply means that somebody is forced to click a button saying I consent, I have read this, and we all know it simply doesn't happen. So that is a false sense of control. What I think I need to do as a regulator, and I'm increasingly seeing that I need to engage on a multi-stakeholder level with industry, with NGOs, with academia. You know, I'm just a small office of, you know, funded $5 million a year, most of which is taken up in overheads. So very little ability to influence the whole of the economy. But you know, if we can together explore the value proposition of privacy by design, for example, as an organization like Apple has realized, you know, that they are building these things in to ensure that control is real and effective and is easily accessible by individuals. Data portability is one small example of that. But I mean, having more granular kind of and easily accessible controls in privacy policies, for example, asking people to take the time to, you know, do you realize that this location service is on all the time, whether you use the app or not? You know, really make that decision. I'm not actually comfortable with that. You know, I see Uber recently changed its terms and conditions of its app to make a binary option that the location controls data on all the time. There's quite a lot of pressure coming on them, and they have responded in the past to pressures around privacy to say, no, you should make it, you know, give us an option to only have the app on while we are using it. So I do think that a lot of this is consumer demand, some is regulator driven, and despite some of the shortcomings of the US approach, I do think that the fair information practice approach, you know, Alex mentioned the Fair Trading Act here, there's scope there for enforcing some of these things to say, listen, you've got a 60-page terms and conditions, which you're saying authorizes you to do whatever you want. Now, strictly as a matter of law, that may comply with the Privacy Act. We haven't looked at it. But is that a fair information, is that a fair practice? Is it a misleading practice? So I think there's lots of scope to, you know, to lead by good example and to lead by, you know, to have regulation and to build consumer demand for better levels of control. It's a very long-winded answer, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
We'll probably have time for one more question. Comment.
I can probably talk about that anyway. I saw Black Mirror season 3, episode 1 as well. There's the citation for you. And the thing I thought about when I saw that episode that you mentioned was the question, are people, are citizens giving away privacy faster than we can pull it back? And what are you thinking about New Zealand as a solution for reaching out to your citizens?
Are people giving away privacy faster than they can get it back? Well, I think we have to, as much as possible, provide people with a means to pull it back. You know, you offer your consent to a service without necessarily knowing how the environment is going to change in the future. I don't accept the assertion that many in the tech world make that, you know, once it's out there for good and you can't ever get it back. And we all know what the Streisand effect is and so on. But in fact, we've seen assertions to the contrary. We've seen Europe say you can have a right to be forgotten. And we can't erase history, but we can break a link, and that may provide an instrumental way of exactly doing as you say, of pulling back some of that privacy. I do think people, we all want to enjoy the benefits of new technology, and sometimes we don't think too deeply about the consequences of that. But that doesn't stop us from recognizing that and taking steps to restore that privacy, or saying, well, I entered into this without fully understanding, so I reserve my right to back out. Your question on education is an important one. Yeah, we do have an obligation to educate people, but I really resile from a tendency to tell people that they shouldn't go on social media or they shouldn't do this. You know, it's not for me to say, you know, you want to increase your social score in the episode that you're talking about, don't do that, it's dangerous. People are going to do it. But we should just make sure that they have good information. And if they've made a mistake, that there should be ways of backing out of that. That they should be able to exit that service and delete their account and leave no trace. I think that's really important. Or if they want to take it to a different service, to be able to do that.